morning, First Congo. We want to invite you this morning to stand with us as we give God the glory this beautiful Sunday morning. Would you sing with us?
To God be the glory, great things he hath done. So loved he the world that he gave us his son, who yielded his life in atonement for sin, and opened the life gate that all may go in. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, let the earth hear his voice. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, let the people rejoice. Oh, come to the Father through Jesus the Son, and give him the glory, great things he hath done. Oh, perfect redemption, the purchase of blood, to every believer the promise of God. The vilest offender who truly believes, that moment from Jesus a pardon receives. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, let the earth hear his voice. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, let the people rejoice. Oh, come to the Father through Jesus the Son, and give him the glory, great things he hath done. Great things he hath taught us, great things he hath done, and great our rejoicing through Jesus the Son. But purer and higher and greater will be our wonder, our transport when Jesus we see. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, let the earth hear his voice. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, let the people rejoice. Oh, come to the Father through Jesus the Son, and give him the glory.
Let's sing out. Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, let the earth hear his voice. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, let the people rejoice. Father through Jesus the Son, and give him the glory, great things he hath done.
Let's give God the glory this morning. Amen. Amen. Well, this morning I want to share a word of encouragement that comes from the book of Ephesians. And this book is a letter from the Apostle Paul to the church in Ephesus. And I think it's such an encouragement. It says, "For this reason I bow my knees before the Father, from whom every family in heaven and on earth is named, that according to the riches of his glory he may grant you to be strengthened with power through his Spirit in your inner being, so that Christ may dwell in your hearts through faith. That you, being rooted and grounded in love, may have strength to comprehend with all the saints what is the breadth and length and height and depth, and to know the love of Christ that surpasses knowledge, that you may be filled with all the fullness of God. Now to him who is able to do far more abundantly than all that we ask or think, according to the power at work within us, to him be glory in the church and in Christ Jesus throughout all generations, forever and ever. Amen." Amen. Well, we're thankful when we bow our knees, when we come together on a Sunday morning, We pray that we would come into a deeper understanding of the love of Jesus Christ that surpasses all knowledge, that can erase all worry and doubt, and can bring us into the presence of God the Father. Would you continue in this time of worship together as we seek God's face and His glory?
Satan fall like lightning, and I saw darkness run for cover. But the miracle that I just can't get over, my name is registered in heaven. And I believe in signs and wonders, and I have resurrection power. Still the miracle that I just can't get over, my name is registered in heaven. My praise belongs to you forever. This is my testimony from death to life. His grace rewrote my story, I'll testify. By Jesus Christ the righteous, I'm justified. This is my testimony, this is my testimony. Come together, sons and daughters, bought with blood and washed in water. Sing the praises of the Spirit, Son and Father. Our God will finish what He started. Yes, our God will finish what He started. Sing. This is my testimony from death to life. Cause grace rewrote my story, I'll testify. By Jesus Christ the righteous, I'm justified. This is my testimony, this is my testimony. If I'm not dead, you're not done. Greater things are still to come. Oh, I believe. If I'm not dead, you're not done. Greater things are still to come. Oh, I believe. If I'm not dead, you're not done. No. Greater things are still to come. Oh, I believe. If I'm not dead, then you're not done. Oh. Greater things are still to come. By Jesus Christ the righteous, I'm justified. This is my testimony, oh, I'm alive. This is my testimony from death to life. Cause grace rewrote my story, I'll testify. By Jesus Christ the righteous, I'm justified. This is my testimony, this is my testimony.
Worthy of our praise, amen. Even through our darkest day, His presence has never left us, and it never will. He never leaves us nor forsakes us. His Spirit abides in and through us. No matter the weather outside, no matter the political party in power, no matter any of the circumstances of this world, even when the moon passes in front of the sun, the presence of God never wavers, and His goodness is true, even when the circumstances of life change. And we know this to be true, and we raise our voices in praise to Him, not just as a mere act or a habit or a ritual, but we recognize God's goodness, God's holiness, and His righteousness, that He alone is worthy of praise. Would you sing this with us this morning? I love You, Lord. Oh, Your mercy never fails me. All my days I've been held in Your hands. The moment that I wake up until I lay my head down, I will sing of the goodness of God. All my life. And all my life You have been faithful. All my life You have been so, so good. Every breath that I am able, I will sing of the goodness of God.
I love Your voice. You have led me through the fire. In darkest night, You are close. Like no other, I've known You as a father, I've known You as a friend. I have lived in the goodness of God.
All my life You have been faithful. All my I've been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, and I will sing of the goodness of God. All my life You have been faithful. And all my You have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, and I will sing of the goodness of
God. Declare this together this morning. Your goodness is running after me.
Your goodness is running after. It's running after me. Your goodness is running after. It's running after me. With my life laid down, I'm surrendered now. I give You everything. Your goodness is running after. It's running after me. Your goodness is running after. It's running after me. Your goodness is running after. It's running after me. With my life laid down, I surrender now. I give You everything. Your goodness is running after.
it's running after me.
And all my life you have been faithful.
Oh, yes, you have.
All my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am in, I will sing of the goodness.
Let's sing that chorus one more time. All my life.
All my life you have been faithful. All my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, I will sing of the goodness of God.
Father God, we know that you are good. You are righteous and holy, and there is none beside you. And Lord, we pray this morning that you would reveal to us through your word, your holiness, your righteousness, your mercy, and your love. God, open our heart, open our ears to hear, open our hearts to receive the truth that Pastor John is going to be sharing with us this morning. God, ready us for change in our lives by your Spirit. Allow us, Lord, to set down the reins, to take up your word, to live by it. God, lead us in this, we pray, in Jesus' name. Amen. You may be seated, and we're going to begin this morning with a reading from Romans 2. Therefore, you have no excuse, O man, everyone who of you who judges, for in passing judgment on another, you condemn yourself, because you, the judge, practice the very same things. We know that the judgment of God rightly falls on those who practice such things. Do you suppose, O man, you who judge those who practice such things and yet do them yourself, that you will escape the judgment of God? Or do you presume on the riches of his kindness and forbearance and patience, not knowing that God's kindness is meant to lead you to repentance? But because of your hand and impenitent heart, you are storing up wrath for yourself on the day of wrath when God's righteous judgment will be revealed. He will render to each one according to his works, to those who by patience and well-doing seek for glory and honor and immortality, he will give eternal life. But for those who are self-seeking and do not obey the truth, but obey unrighteousness, there will be wrath and fury. There will be tribulation and distress for every human being who does evil, the Jew first and also the Greek. But glory and honor and peace for everyone who does good, the Jew first and also the Greek. For God shows no partiality. For all who have sinned without the law will also perish without the law, and all who have sinned under the law will be judged by the law. For it is not the hearers of the law who are righteous before God, but the doers of the law who will be justified. For when Gentiles who do not have the law by nature do what the law requires, they are a law to themselves, even though they do not have the law. They show that the work of the law is written on their hearts, while their conscience also bears witness, and their conflicting thoughts accuse or even excuse them on that day when, according to my gospel, God judges the secrets of men by Christ Jesus. But if you call yourself a Jew and rely on the law and boast in God and know his will approve what is excellent because you are instructed from the law, and if you are sure that you yourself are a guide to the blind, a light to those who are in the darkness, an instructor of the foolish, a teacher of children, having in the law the embodiment of knowledge and truth, you then who teach others, do you not teach yourself? While you preach against stealing, do you steal? You who say that one must not commit adultery, do you commit adultery? You who abhor idols, do you rob temples? You who boast in the law, dishonor God by breaking the law. For as it is written, the name of God is blasphemed among the Gentiles because of you. For circumcision indeed is of value if you obey the law. But if you break the law, your circumcision becomes uncircumcision. For if a man who is uncircumcised keeps the precepts of the law, will not his uncircumcision be regarded as circumcision? Then he who is physically uncircumcised but keeps the law will condemn you who have the written code and circumcision but break the law. For no one is a Jew who is merely one outwardly, nor is circumcision outward and physical, but a Jew is one inwardly, and circumcision is a matter of the heart by the Spirit, not by the letter. His praise is not from man, but from God.
Well, may the Lord bless the reading of his word. And kids, you're dismissed at this time to head out. You've heard the word of the Lord, and now you can go and study that in your context and your world. And so thank you for those who serve in that way. For those of you online, we are thankful that you have joined with us. We began a study last week in the book of Romans. And over the next number of weeks until chapter 16, we're going to press through to hear what the Apostle Paul has written here for us to help us understand. Now, this is a little much more of a teaching style. We're trying to go as verse by verse, expositionally. That's called an exposition of the Scripture. And so we are certainly covering, we're not going to hit every verse, but we'll certainly try to help you understand what Paul's message is to this blended church. You saw it in the passage this morning already. This blended church of Jews and Gentiles who happen to live in Rome. And so as you're listening, I hope that you'll stay with us. There's the passage in the Scriptures is there in front of you. I'm going to have you refer to another passage in Psalms, so if you have your Bible ready, it's Psalms 19 in a minute. You're going to go there. Psalm 19, we're going to look at a passage. It's on page 481 in the Pew Bible, or 482, if you want to look at that. So we're digging in here to help us understand this foundation of solid biblical truth that should be transformative in your life. That's where our whole focus has been. I referred to this last week in terms of the Bible Project, and where it talks about faith in Jesus Christ creates new humans who were liberated to become a people characterized by love for God and their neighbors. This new humanity is being transformed by God's Spirit and is the fulfillment of God's ancient promises. Aren't you glad? Aren't you glad that you have a chance at transformational thinking? Aren't you glad that you're not just left with your frail, limited perspective on life and the world? Aren't you glad? It ought to cause you and I to know that, look, when we realize how much we aren't, we realize all that God is, and that we can be transformed by the power of the Word of God and our obedience to the spirit of the law. That passage that we just come, we'll come to it. Not the letter of the law, that we don't serve the rigidity of you have to do this and you have to do that and you do all of these things and therefore that makes you right with God. God makes us right with Him first by His righteousness. And He brings then our life into consistently with Him and His person as He transforms us into a person who from the heart wants to be like Jesus. It's not some rigid, you have to be, or you're doing this out of a sense of duty, like we've all been at some point motivated in our lives. Duty will not sustain you. The love of God and the love of the person of Jesus Christ, the reason we elevate Him is because He is the sole motivator that makes you want to be different. Once we realize that we need that difference. And it is that that whole element of faith, hope, and love, which Paul talks about here. That the first part of this is God's gift of rescuing humanity through Jesus Christ. That's the hope. Faith is that God maintains His promises to Israel. He used Israel as this picture of how He's going to upend the world on this one nation. Now, if there isn't any time in all of human history where you could see it, I don't know how God's all going to work it out. We know that in the Bible, He is all going to work it out. But the world is completely focused on this country, this little strip of ground that has no natural resources other than a gas line that runs out in the Mediterranean Sea, which isn't much. But they are fascinated. Why? Because they're God's chosen race and God's chosen people. And He said, I'm going to show the world about this little place called Israel and Jerusalem to bring peace to the world eventually. Jesus Christ Himself will rule and reign from Jerusalem, my friends. Mark it down. The Bible's clear. Now, you and I get a chance to have a front row seat in observing history. And you and I get a front row seat in saying how God wants to change your life and my life right now, right here in a miracle on Mulberry Street. God's doing it right here, right now. He's going to do so through the power of the Word of God. And that's what Romans 1 is about, because love is the thing that's going to unify the diversity and the torn up waste of the church. But it's going to get uglier. I've told you before, it's going to get uglier and worse before it gets better. Because the wrath of God has to begin revealed against all unrighteousness until people totally get to the end of themselves, and that life will not work at an individual level, at a community level, at a corporate level, at a national level, at a global level, until the world completely pursues it to the end and realizes, man, this is messed up. It won't stop. We will not stop to choose love until we go to the end logical extreme of total destruction. Look at your own personal life. Were it not for God stepping into your life, you'd already been destroyed, wouldn't you? I was thinking about it the other day. My brother told me, John, he told me when I was in high school, listen, if you don't change your ways, you're not going to live to be 25. My mother told me, you got to love her. She gave me another 10 years. She said, son, if you don't change, you're going to not live to be 35. Every time after 35, man, I'm living on the gravy train. Why? Because my hard-headedness and stubbornness was so against God and so self-centered, self-focused, were it not for the transforming work of God, I would have nothing. I would not be here. Certainly not telling you about this. Not urging you and I to walk in light of holiness. I love the song we just sang. Oh, the goodness of God. All the goodness of God that has reached you in your condition. I don't know how bad you are, but I know how bad my heart is. And I'll tell you what, I'm glad for the goodness of God. It's one of my favorite songs. I listen to it. It's on my favorite playlist on Spotify. CC Winans sings it. Oh, my goodness. The goodness of God. His love is running after you. It's running after you. And that is the passage that we want to talk about this morning. That's what Romans is about. It introduces Romans 1 through 4, this need for human rescue. It tells us in this situation that we're in that we need the Savior. Chapter 5 through 8 focuses on how Jesus forms a new covenant family. Not just Jewish, but Jews and Gentiles who come together as one, who are centralized in Jesus Christ. Chapters 9 through 11 talks about how God doesn't give up on His covenant people. God hasn't forgotten the Jewish people. God hasn't forsaken them. It's looked bad at multiple times in history, and you'll see some of the harshness that has come upon the Jewish people, admittedly, from the Bible, is because they have chosen to walk their own way as God's chosen people, and there is a stricter judgment. It's true. It's true. The Word of God said it would be that way, and it has come true. And chapters 12 through 16 is going to talk about how love heals and unifies Jesus' family, and how He then has called us to this. Now, Romans 1 last week, we covered the power of the gospel. It's that powerful verse, I am not ashamed of the gospel of Christ. It's the power of God unto salvation to everyone who believes. I hope you look that up again and memorize that verse, Romans 1, 16 and 17. You ought to have that in your arsenal, because it talks about the foundation of your faith against the backdrop of the peril of godlessness. It's showing you this contrast that if it's not faith you choose, it's wrath you get. There's only two options. There's only two teams. There's only two ways to go. There's only a double option on the path. And what he's saying is, look, choose faith. So then it goes into our passage today we just read. What is righteous judgment, and how does God's law judge humanity? So if wrath was where we ended last week, we ended there because of this whole thing about what the propensity of us is to judge. Have you noticed that you're a little judgy from Judgy Town, like we say at our house? Right? We do have a little sense to be a little judgmental on one another. But the passage goes back and look, he says, look, don't forget Romans chapter 2. You stand right at the gate of this idea. We're going to look at it again. We come off of the list of 25 different sins. I challenged each of you last week. Hey, you probably found your name in there somewhere, right? It's really small print in the Bible. But if you couldn't find your list of in the middle of that, it's this reminder that these 25 sins that are listed at the end of Romans 1, if they don't hit you, if you say, you know what, John, I led that through there. I didn't find myself there one bit. This passage is for you because you're part of Judgy Town, okay? Because if you got missed before, we're going to get you again. The Word of God said, look, if you're so super righteous that you don't think you are a sinner, then you got another set of issues. Remember the Pharisees, right? They were so committed to the law that they strained at the gnat, as Jesus said, and swallowed the camel. And that's what happens to us. So this idea of judging is really important. Now you think, well, John, don't we have to judge some things in life? Do we have to make some determinations? Yes. Well, there's two words in the Bible that talk about judgment. Actually, both of them are used here. And think of it in this way. First off, there's the judgment of discernment that makes you determine between seeing something that's good or bad for you. So think about, some of you did this morning when you went to get your banana, right? You looked. You know, you had maybe two sets of bananas, or you had two bananas. One's a little on the darker side, looking on the outside, and then one's looking a little fresher, and then you made a determination. You made a judgment. That one goes in the pile for banana bread later, and this one goes for this morning. Now, some of you might be a mushy banana eater. That's okay. We don't judge you if you want to eat a mushy banana. Okay, for me, I got to have a green banana. Right, because I wasn't sure I was going to live very long. I don't even buy green bananas. I said, you know, I want to make them sure they're just right. That's the kind of judgment it's first talking about. But then there's a second word for judgment. It's a word that literally means to judge down. If you were to translate it literally, it uses the word to judge with the idea of condemning. And both of these words are here used. It says, you're passing judgment on one another. You condemn yourself. That's the idea. Because you judge, you who judge practice the very same things. Now, what we're going to learn about God's judgment in this is it's different than your judgment. Because we can get caught up in judging these things. Remember what we looked about last week? Remember, this was the list. For this reason, God gave them up to dishonorable passions. Their women exchanged natural relations for those who were contrary to nature. The men likewise gave up natural relations with women, were consumed with passion for one another. Men committing shameless acts with men and receiving in themselves the due penalty for their error. So there's a moral problem. Then, didn't catch you there. 128, and since they did not see fit to acknowledge not God, God gave them up to a debased mind to do what they ought not to be done. They were filled with all manner of unrighteousness, evil, covetousness, malice, full of envy, murder, strife, deceit, maliciousness. They are gossips, slanderers, haters of God, insolent, haughty, boastful, inventors of evil, disobedient to parents, foolish, faithless, heartless, ruthless. Though they know God's righteousness, decree that those who practice such things deserve to die, they not only do them, but give approval to those who practice them. All right. This is you guys, okay? Okay? You want to know who you are. Here we go. Did you find yourself in the list? Well, if not, remember, you're coming. Judge ye. Here's the point. You and I are not probably going to give righteous judgment because we're harder on others than we are ourselves. Almost always. Really. So, what is righteous judgment? I'm going to contrast these two passages. And we're going to stay with me on the left column, on the God column first. We're going to jump around just a little bit. But before we get there, I want you to recognize that it's this reality that God has this righteous judgment he wants us to understand, and it's his law that accomplishes it. Now, what do we know about the law? So before we get into there, go to the Psalm 19, because I want you to know what the law is really supposed to produce in you and me, how it is going to transform you. So Psalm 19 is a wonderful passage. Of course, many of you might have read it this last week because it talks about the heavens declare the glory of God. On Monday, we saw this eclipse and this amazing experience. But the latter part of that is that in you look above and you see the sky above and you recognize that there is God. But then he's given it in his perfect word. And Psalm 19, verse 7 begins like this. The law of the Lord is perfect, reviving the soul. The testimony of the Lord is sure, making wise the simple. The precepts of the Lord are right, rejoicing the heart. The commandment of the Lord is pure, enlightening the eyes. The fear of the Lord is clean, enduring forever. The rules of the Lord are true and righteous altogether. More to be desired are they than gold, even than much fine gold. Sweeter also than honey and the drippings of the honeycomb. Moreover, by them is your servant warned, and in keeping of them, there is great reward. Here's the thing. God says, look, following me is not just about obeying the law, but Jesus would later tell his disciples, look, if you love me, you're going to keep my commandments. If you love me, you're going to do those things which I know are going to, not for God's benefit, they're for our benefit. And when we understand God's law, it's not something that's austere to take away. It's actually something that gives us the boundary line so we can play within God's freedom for us. And breaking God's law always brings upon it the wrath of God that says, look, playing outside of bounds is always going to hurt you. It's going to hurt you at multiple levels. It's going to hurt you in your heart and your soul. It's going to hurt you in the delivery of your life. And then it's going to come and bring with it this whole element we're going to touch on in a minute, is this conscience that convicts you and makes you feel badly and gives you that sick feeling in the pit of your stomach that says, this isn't right. God says, look, I want you to live in a place of freedom where you experience the things that God says about his judgment. What are they, first of all? First of all, it says that they are fair and consistent. Look there in verse chapter 2 and verse 2 on your paper that we had put in the bulletin. The reminder is that there is this whole thing that God's law is fair and consistent. It rightly falls, the Bible tells us. It rightly falls. Let me get back to the passage. I quote it properly. We know that the judgment of God rightly falls on all those who do such things. What things? Well, the list of 25 plus the judgment. So God rightly falls on us. There's not anyone who's really honest with themselves that knows it. You know what? There's plenty in my life that God could judge me for to condemn me to hell. We all know that. Well, the amazing thing is that God would consider and provide a way of escape from what we all deserve. Now, if we start comparing to each other's stuff, we can all find somebody who's worse than us, and you can all find somebody who in your judgment is better than you. Aren't you glad we're not supposed to be comparing against each other? Paul later told the Corinthians, look, comparing themselves amongst themselves, they are not wise. In other words, you want to go down the path of wisdom, just compare yourself to somebody else all the time. Think, well, why do they get this and they get that? And why is there seem to be elevated and I seem to be put down or vice versa? Why do you get elevated and others seem to get put down? The Bible says, look, that's not yours to consider. That's not yours to judge. God gives each what he knows to get you to be transformed. That's the point. God knew exactly what he needed to accomplish in my life to get me to the place to say, I'll submit. We sang it just a moment ago. I'll submit my will to you, Lord. And he's doing the exact same thing in your life. He's getting you to the place to conform you to the image of his son. And he's going to use the people and the series of events to get you there. Because he rightly is fair and consistent. And he gives us what he gives us. Now, understand this. This is his heart in it. Look at chapter verse 4. Or don't you presume on the riches of his kindness and forbearance and patience, not knowing that God's kindness is meant to lead you to repentance. Well, I've read this this verse many, many times, particularly talking with parents whose kids have walked away from their faith. I think, how should I respond? Well, if we want to respond God, like God's response, recognize that forbearance, patience, kindness is what God desires to draw people to himself. Now, here's the thing. Many people don't receive that. Wrath, judgment, hardness, hardship, consequences have to correct us. Most of us don't learn very well with gentle instruction. Have I got an amen? Right? You've heard me talk about two before therapy before. Most of us. I'm not the only one. Now, some of you are gentle and kind and caring naturally, I think. Right? At least you seem that way, in my judgment. But here's what he's telling us. Look, what God's saying is, look, I want you to be filled with this kindness. I want you to be experiencing the riches of this excellence, and that it is this forbearance and patience that does it. Patient endurance is what the word forbearance means. And it has the idea of holding back the coming judgment. So when somebody's on a long run away from God, here's what we do know for sure. Judgment's coming. Somewhere, some way. The judgment of God deals with, consequentially, everyone's sin at its right time. But sometimes the Lord lets people go a long, long time. I was reading the book of Kings this last week, and man, there were some kings. Manasseh, the worst king of all their life, he reigned for 55 years. He was a horrible human being. Sacrificed his own kids on altars. Celebrated the misuse of the temple. He was a horrible king. God said he was a horrible king. And let him, and he lived, was the longest reigning king. God allows in his forbearance a lot of evil to go along for a long time. But know that it's his kindness. He's maybe given people a long enough time in hopes that they'll turn back. And it seems like sometimes the people who are the really in tune with the things of God and all of that. Have you known somebody somewhere in your life who's been a young person who had a heart for the things of God, who died early? All of us have somebody probably in our life. I remember a young man who had in my first youth group, I was 19, he was a ripe old age 18. I was trying to help coach him, and he was coaching me, and he was killed in a construction accident, 18 years old. This guy had more on the ball spiritually. He was interested in the things of God. He was gone. Maybe the reason I've lived as long as I have is God said, listen, I'm going to be patient with that boy. He's got a long ways to go. He needs my forbearance and my patience. He's going to need a longer runway. Have you considered that maybe the reason the Lord's leaving you around, sometimes those of you who get on the north end of life wonder, well, why is God leaving me around? Maybe he's really giving you a chance to say, man, God, you're it. And I'll depend upon you till the very day I die. Maybe that's why. And then maybe God's got a purpose for you and I to experience his forbearance and his patience, his kindness. And then it's all connected to obedience. Verse 7 and verse 10. Verse 7 says this in chapter 2. To those who are by patience and well-doing seek for glory and honor and immortality, he will give eternal life. Now, this is not teaching a work salvation. What he's not teaching is, okay, if just by doing good you get in. What he's saying is you're doing good because they're already in. In other words, they've already experienced eternal life, and therefore their character is pursuing good and right. For those who by patience in doing good seek for glory. In other words, they've put their faith in the Lord, and they're letting good flow out of their life. Verse 10. But glory and honor and peace for everyone who does good. In other words, doing good is not goodness for earning rights. It's goodness as a byproduct or an outflow of a life that has been touched by the goodness of God. Does that make sense? Isaiah already told us, all of our righteousness outside of God is as filthy rags. So there are no good people. There are only people who have experienced God's goodness who extend God's goodness as a connection of him, not us. Anything we see in one another's life that's good is ultimately connected with God. If you and I are taking credit for it, it becomes not good. And then it's self-seeking and self-serving, and it's all about you. Your goodness, my good works are about patting myself on the back. And does that please God? Never. So God's trying to purify our heart, and he's saying, listen, I want you connected to obedience so that you have a long passion towards him and that you are allowing him to do that. So God's judgment, it's fair and consistent, it's full of kindness, and it's connected to obedience. In contrast, human judgment is this. It's hypocritical. We've already seen that. The point is, he says, you practice these very things, you're complaining about everybody else doing. And this is why I made the point of, look, you read that passage, you can find yourself some area. You might not be as bad as the person in some other part of the passage, but you can find yourself. And he's saying, look, if you practice these things, you're full of hard-heartedness and harshness. In other words, you're not seeing your own sin for what it is. And you're elevating and making other sin big and you're small. That's the evidence of an impenitent heart. And that's the thing that Jesus argued with the Pharisees so much about. That's why he was so hard on the Pharisees. Because what? They had the right knowledge, but it didn't show up in compassion. It didn't show up in how that they cared. In fact, they were then, you know, standing on the street corner doing those things because their obedience was connected to the disobedience of being self-seeking and self-serving in their expression of religiousness. That's what happens. It's a difference in being religious and being related to God who produces goodness from your life. Does that make sense? So what he's teaching here is, look, this is righteous judgment. And if it ends up being this hard-hearted, this stubborn, this unrepentant, acting for one's own gain and for your best interest of yourself, said you've missed God judging righteously. That's hard truth, isn't it? Don't you want to end up on the left hand of this column and say, God, I want to be in here. I want to model this kind of behavior where my kindness leads people to repentance. Where my desire is based on obedience to let my knowledge and my conscience and my thoughts show up in my actions. Well, I'm glad you guys came to that conclusion because that's the next part of the passage. And that's how this works. How the law judges humanity is this longer passage. For verse 12 says, for all who have sinned without the law will also perish without the law. So that's where it gets into the question of, well, what does God do with the person who doesn't understand the law of God, who doesn't understand who Jesus is? What's the fairness of all of that? And that's where the Bible says, look, God has imprinted into every human heart this desire for God and a God awareness and a God knowledge. And what he says is, he said, I'm going to pull their limited knowledge in. So those that have limited knowledge are not judged with two sets of rules, but those who have limited knowledge are judged differently with those with deep knowledge, right? You judge a kid who's 4 different than you judge a kid who's 2. Why? Because the 4-year-old should have a little bit more ability to say no, what no means. The 2-year-old, they're learning what no means. They can know what no means, but they don't understand the implications of it. Fast forward to a person who's 64. To a person who's 4. You see the difference? Limited knowledge versus deep knowledge. And what he's teaching us is, look, knowledge and conscience you'll notice, in the thing I talked about a minute ago, the prick in your heart that says to you, that ain't right. You know what I'm saying? You come to a situation and you see it in your own heart and you go a place in your own heart and your head and you know better and your conscience says, that's not right. That's not right. It's a warning flag. It's the warning signal saying, hey, this isn't the right way to do it. A warning, warning. And then it lines up with your thoughts that has the ability to say, oh, stop. Or, oh, that conscious thing, that's for somebody else. I'm just going to go right on. Which we've all gone right on. We've all come to the stop sign and not stopped, right? Matter of fact, 2 weeks ago, a police officer pulled me over and told me that happened. Right here in Kokomo. He said, I pulled you over for 2 reasons. I said, I'm sure you did, officer. Number one, you had a rolling stop. Number two, you were on your cell phone holding it up to your head. Oh. He said, you do understand that's a $500 fine. I said, yes, sir, I do now. Why? Because what? I came to a rolling stop and ignored the law because I have a deep knowledge of the law. And I knew kind of it was wrong for me to have my phone out like that. He said, I have a hands-free option. I said, oh, good. And thankfully, he said, I'm just going to give you a warning today. I got the lucky dog pass. But here's the thing. We all come to a rolling stop in our lives. It's not that I didn't know better. It's just that my conscience said the values of things that I thought were more important, like talking on the phone and getting to the place faster than I thought I needed to, didn't affect my thoughts to introduce my behavior to say, John, stop at this stop sign and put your phone down. So I went ahead and did what I want. And so the judge said, John, you can't do that. And in his mercy, said, John, you're okay. I'm not going to do it again, at least today, at least today. Not till the next time he gives me a ticket. And the Lord will say, hey, John, you now you pay $150 because you wouldn't obey the law. The consequence of it. That's right. You gave me a good illustration for today. Here's the point. Verse 13, for it is not the hearers of the law who are righteous before God, but the doers of the law who will be justified. For when Gentiles who do not have the law by nature do what the law requires, they are a law to themselves, even though they do not have the law. In other words, they have a sense about it that you shouldn't be on your cell phone and shouldn't have rolling stops. You see, I had deep knowledge, but I disobeyed it. They have limited knowledge, but they got common sense. Yeah, probably shouldn't do that. And they listen to their heart, and that's what happens. The law, the work of the law is written on their hearts, while their conscience also bears witness, and their conflicting thoughts accuse or even excuse them. On that day when, according to my gospel, God judges the secrets of men by Christ Jesus. Ultimately, God's going to deal with all of our stuff. He's going to deal with all of your rolling stops too. I'm not the only one rolling stopping, I promise you. But if you call yourself, then he goes on. He said, but no, look, there's a certain additional standard for those of you who have deep knowledge. And that is the Jewish people. Now, what God pours out upon the Jewish people is this reminder that, look, I've given you this deep knowledge because you're chosen, you're connected to God, you're going to know his will from the mountain of God. God gave you this. You know what's excellent, and that's the next part of this passage. You know his will, and you approve what is excellent. You're instructed from the law. Look what he tells him. He said, and if you're sure that you're yourself a guide to the blind and light to those who are in the darkness, an instructor of the foolish, a teacher of children, having in the law the embodiment of knowledge of the truth. Who but the Jewish people and the Jewish nation through the Ten Commandments has influenced more of the world, the Ten Commandments, more law influenced all over the world from that set of laws? They had the greatest influence. They were handed it down first. And they've influenced the world in such a way. But then he challenges the Jewish people particularly and says, you who teach others, do you not teach yourself? When you preach against stealing, don't you steal? When you teach committing adultery, you commit adultery. And when you abhor idols, you still rob temples. And the idea of robbing temples is you abhor the fact that they have idolatrous worship. And then you go to your temple but don't bring your tithe and offering. And it says, you're robbing God. Later on in Malachi, it says, would a man rob God by keeping what God says to give? And that was a problem, and it still is a problem. Goes back to, again, for this reason, the name of God is blasphemed. So here's what I want you to know here at the end of this. And I think I skipped this last section. I'm sorry. Let me go back one. For it's written, the name of God is blasphemed among the Gentiles because of you. In other words, if it doesn't work for them, why should it work for us? That's what the common potential is. And even so, more so, even right now, with the scrutiny that's on the Jewish people right now in Israel. For circumcision indeed is of any value if you obey the law, but if you break the law, your circumcision becomes uncircumcision. The whole idea of circumcision was that God said, hey, this is a symbol for you that you've made you a holy nation, a people set aside for God. In other words, but if you don't understand the symbol and you go ahead and violate that from the heart, he said, you missed the point. It's never about the external, it's about the internal that drives the behavior. Internal has to change us. It goes on. So if a man, verse 26, who is uncircumcised keeps the precepts of the law, will not his uncircumcision be regarded as circumcision? In other words, God's going to make the Gentiles who disregard that part of the Jewish people, which was the whole issue with the Pharisees, who said, not on our watch. We, you know, they're still fighting about it because Paul says the Gentiles can come in and we'll make of them one race focused on Jesus, which is still a problem today. Verse 27, then he who is physically uncircumcised but keeps the law will condemn you who have written the coded and circumcision but break the law. Here's the last thing. He says it's based upon this obedience to the spirit and not the letter. It's understanding the heart of that. Until I mentally make the transition in my life that what the officer is trying to do in my life is to help me, John, don't kill somebody else by rolling through a stop sign, and don't kill yourself by having distracted driving on your phone. Until I get the spirit of that, none of you will be surprised when you say, well, John was finally in an accident that took him out. My wife certainly won't be surprised. Now, I'm not trying to speak it into existence, but here's the deal. That's truth. That's reality. Until I change my ways and my behavior, I may bear the consequences of that. We all make conscious choices like that all the time. Our conscience choices. And that's just in a small illustration of much greater things. For no one is a Jew who is merely one outwardly, nor is circumcision outward and physical. But a Jew is one inwardly, and circumcision is a matter of the heart by the spirit, not the letter. His praise is not from man, but from God. Here's the point. God wants you to say this about this passage, I believe. Am I aligning with God's judgment or human judgment? I've given you hopefully enough in this passage to go back and forth and say, hey, am I aligning my heart with God's judgment? Is kindness coming out into my life where it's changing my life? And then am I obeying the law of the law to make myself right? Or am I obeying the law of the Spirit because it's coming from a heart that wants to please the Lord? He said, well, John, what if I don't want to please the Lord? That's a problem, isn't it? Does anybody have that problem? I don't want to see your head raise their hands. I'm going to assume everybody. Okay? That's where you have to say, God, create in me a clean heart and renew a right spirit with me. Ask God to give you the wanter that he wants for your life. If you want what he wants, it will lead you to the place of seeking his law and his word for your life and saying, God, this is what I desire to be well pleased in my life. My friends, the purpose and the teaching of this, Romans chapter 2, is to bring us to saying, look, I've got to see the world with God's judgment and not my own. And I've got to bring my life into alignment of his kindness in my life. I got to do it for the right set of reasons from the heart, not because it's got to come from the heart. Ask God for the right wanter, and he'll give it to you. God, I thank you for this day, this truth. Set it free to our lives. Bind our hearts to those which are eternally significant. And guide and direct us in a path that seeks your heart from the Spirit, obeys the letter because we obey the Lord. guide and direct and protect each one as we pursue you. In the name of Jesus, amen.
As we close this morning in our time of teaching together, we want to go back to that song that we sang before the sermon started. A song about the goodness of God, His faithfulness, and the sacrifice and the surrender that we need in our lives to receive fully from God. So we want to invite you to sing this out. And if you want to sit, that's fine. If you want to stand, that's fine. This is a time where we can reflect. This is a time where we can pray. This is a time where we can really dwell on the words that John has shared with us this morning. So, listen as this is sung over you, and sing it out if you desire. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. My life laid down, I'm surrendered now, I give you everything. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. Oh. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. With my life laid down, I'm surrendered now, I give you everything. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me.
We're going to sing that one more time, your goodness.
Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. With my life laid down, I'm surrendered now, I give you everything. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me.
And all my life you have been faithful. All my life you have been so good. With every breath that I am able, I will sing of the goodness.
All my life you have been faithful.
And all my life you have been faithful. And all my life you have been so good. With every breath that I am able, I will sing of the goodness of God. I will sing of the goodness of God. I will sing of the goodness of God.
And Father God, we are thankful that your righteousness, that your holiness, it reveals in us our weakness. It reveals in us our shortcoming, God. It reveals in us our sin. And God, by your Spirit, we come to the knowledge that only you are righteous, that only you are faithful, that only you are good. And God, we come to a realization of our deep need for you. And God, I pray that as we recognize your love and your mercy, we recognize your righteousness, that we would set down the things of this world that have distracted us. The good that's not great, God. We need your greatness. We need your goodness alone. Help us, God, to take up your word. God, that your law would be written on our hearts. God, our conscience would be dictated by your precepts. We thank you, Lord, that you have revealed this to us, your little children, this wisdom of old. And so we thank you, God, for this truth. We pray that it would change our lives every day. In Jesus' name, amen.